which is presented on this picture, which is composed of Manel Bosch, Aguilera, Jérôme Beugnon, Raphaël Bougan, Elisa Soave left us for Innsbruck to do her PhD, and we were recently joined by Alexis Germaoui. So I will emphasize work done on ultra-cold ytterbium atoms in this talk. I want to advertise very quickly an article we have put on archive, which is an optics work, where we showed how we could use, basically, interference or Fourier optics to probe the topological properties of quasi-crystals, Fibonacci chains in the particular example. So in this talk, I'm going to concentrate on the behavior of bosonic ytterbium in optical lattices. And basically, the goal in our project is to realize with these ultra-cold atoms, bosonic atoms, the analog of what can be called orbital magnetism in solid-state physics. So just as an introduction, basically, for electronic systems which have an electric charge, there are a lot of very important and very interesting phenomena that happens when you put them in a strong magnetic field. So I remind you here that in quantum mechanics, the way to describe this, which would be the quantum equivalent of a Lorentz force, is to introduce a vector potential, A, related to B by a rotational. And then this vector potential will couple to the electronic motion through this minimal coupling Hamiltonian, P minus QA over squared over 2m, which replaces familiar kinetic energy, p squared over 2m. Okay. So now, because of this, of the particular features of this Hamiltonian, there are many phenomena that are observed. For example, all the phenomena related to Landau diamagnetism, Chubnikov-Dyer oscillations, etc. It's also a very important tool to study coherence in mesoscopic physics, vortices in type 2 superconductors, and maybe most importantly for my purpose, also various quantum Hall effects. And so you know that probably that quantum Hall effects come in two varieties, integer and fractional. What I want to advertise here is a fractional version because it corresponds to the emergence in two-dimensional electron gases or liquids. It corresponds to the emergence of strongly correlated phases of matter, what Norbert Schur called quantum matter yesterday. And so they are characterized by an energy gap, meaning that they form incompressible liquids. And the excitation on top of the ground state are very exotic. They behave as anions, that is excitations which carry a fraction of the electron charge and which behave in a manner intermediate between bosons and fermions. And the name anions. And so the fractional statistics is something which has eluded observation even since the discovery of these phases in the 80s. And which has, which has triggered a lot of interest for fundamental reasons, but also eventually for applications in quantum informations, quantum memories, etc. Okay, so about 20 years ago, it was predicted that in ultra-cold atomic gases, it is in principle possible to observe similar phases to the quantum Hall states, the fractional quantum Hall states observed in electronic systems. Okay. But this is experimentally extremely difficult to realize. And so far, there has been no observation of these states. And what I want to motivate here is how to basically realize this type of states with ultra-cold atoms. And so the first ingredient that we need is basically a vector potential coupling to the motion of the ultra-cold atoms in the same way a vector potential couples to the motion of electrons, okay? And so at first sight, it seems a bit lost. Of course, for atoms are electrically neutral, so Q equal to zero, and so apparently game over. So it's not so, and the reason is that we can exploit an analogy, property of quantum mechanics, which is that the physics encoded in this Hamiltonian is completely equivalent to the fact that when a charged particle moves in an applied magnetic field, it will pick up a phase, so-called Aronoff-Bohm phase, which will depend on the charge, Q, and on the circulation of the vector potential along the trajectory, so to speak. Okay. And so by a simple manipulation, you can relate this if a particle moves around a closed contour to the flux of B through the surface that the trajectory encloses. And so this phase is realizing this phase is basically equivalent to realizing this type of Hamiltonian. And it turns out that using the tools of quantum optics, coherent atom-like coupling in particular, one can apply this type of phase, which are geometric phase, to the atomic wave function. And in that way, it's equivalent to realizing an effective magnetic field, if you want, coupling to the atomic motion. So for our purpose, we'll not exactly try to realize this type of thing, which would be valid for a particle in the bulk, but we'll rather go to a lattice in a time binding regime, so where basically you have only nearest neighbor hopping to the neighboring sites. And in that case, the translation of this Hamiltonian is a tight binding Hamiltonian connecting neighboring site Ri and Rj, but with complex tunneling matrix elements, okay? And the phase, so J is real here, the phase of this matrix element can be understood in the same way as the Aronoff-Bohn phase I just discussed. So for a magnetic field perpendicular to the lattice plane in two dimensions, this phase connecting this site and that site will be proportional to the integral between from the starting point to the end point for this particular hopping process of the vector potential along this straight line. Okay. And then, similarly as in the bulk, you can also see this the phase corresponding to this Aronoff-Bohm phase as the flux that is pierced by a unit cell when you the magnetic flux pierced by a unit cell. And when a particle moves along, makes a close contour along this unit cell, then it will correspond also to 2 pi alpha in my notation would correspond to the phase picked up by the particle. Okay. And so alpha is related to the charge, so which would be 1 for us, to the magnetic field strength, and to the surface d squared of the unit cell. And so for that reason, in real solids, when the unit cell has a size of 1 angstrom typically, even for a very large field of 50 Tesla, alpha is always very small. And so this picture, this time binding picture, is not really relevant, and it basically reduces to the bulk picture. But now, either in some solid state superlattices, so artificial structures, or with cold atoms, or now also other realizations that I should mention, we can reach alpha on the order of 2 pi, basically, meaning that we can explore the full generality of this lattice Hamiltonian, with a particular band structure known as Hofstadter butterfly, which we heard about yesterday, and so on. Okay? So this has been realized experimentally already by several approaches, which I list here in 2 broad categories. Okay? One of them, which I would call the quantum optics approach, uses internal state, which are coupled by 1 or 2 photon transitions, so driven by laser-driven, basically. The other approach doesn't use internal state, but rather it uses a quickly modulated potential, which is modulated very quick compared to the typical time scale for the atomic motion. And then in kind of a secular Hamiltonian emerges, which has a desired property, so which reproduces, for example, the Hofstadter the Harper Hamiltonian that I've described in the last slide. So this has been observed so far at the single particle level, but for one exception, for the particular flux alpha equal 1/2, which corresponds now to, so alpha equal 1/2 corresponds to an alternating sign of the tunneling matrix element. So they are real, but they are plus J, minus J, and so on. And in which case, BEC was reported. You see an example here where you see that this is without flux. And now with flux, you see additional peaks, which reflect the fact that there is a modification of the band structure due to the additional artificial magnetic field. So this has been observed in 2D and 3D. But now for other values, to my knowledge, it has been impossible so far to observe such a similar picture, so to observe a system that stays condensed when you load it into this band structure. And the reason is that there is generally heating associated to this experiment, with a fairly short BEC lifetime. So this is a curve where you plot the visibility of this interference pattern versus the depth of the lattice. And you see that the typical lifetime is on the order of a few tenths of milliseconds, which is relatively short for the time scales of typical experiments with ultra-cold atoms. So this is clearly a problem that needs to be addressed. It is generally believed that the reason is that interactions can somehow disrupt some of these approaches, especially the Floquet approach, which is no longer valid as long as atoms interact. But so this also motivates to explore, let's say, other paths to realize these artificial magnetic fields. And this is what I'm going to explain now. One so far not realized method, which relies on a so-called optical clock transition. Okay. So clock transitions appear in certain atoms, not everyone, most typically group 2 atoms, such as ytterbium or strontium, for instance. These atoms have a level structure like this. It's basically similar to helium. So you have a family of spin singlet state and a family of spin triplet states. And then the ground state has a total spin 0. And there is some particular excited state, which also has electronic angular momentum 0 for both the ground state and this particular excited state. So normally, this transition would be forbidden. So it's, in fact, there are tricks to make it very weakly allowed to excite it anyway. But the fact that it's a J equals 0 to 0 transition means there is virtually no spontaneous emission associated with this type of transition. The state here is metastable with a very long lifetime, typically tens of seconds or more. Okay? So basically, this means that it allows for coherent manipulation on this transition. And historically, this has been explored first in the context of atomic clocks, where people use now routinely this type of very narrow optical transition to build clocks with unprecedented frequency stability on the order of 10 millihertz or something, so a quality factor of 10 to the 17. Okay? And so those are the best, by far the best atomic, well, not by far, but the best atomic clock that are currently available today in national metrology labs. Okay? So there are other interests of using these atoms. But here, my motivation is basically to the existence of such transition, okay, which can be used, for example, to build spin-orbit coupling, or, as I'm going to explain, to realize so-called off-shatter optical lattices, which is basically the optical lattice with an equipped magnetic flux, as I've explained previously. Okay. So one way to do it is to make use of the fact that since we are using two different electronic states, then there is a lot of freedom to choose the shape of the optical potential and how it affects both states. So I'm showing here the polarizability, the electric polarizability for the ytterbium atom as a function of the wavelength of the laser that you will use to trap it. And what you can notice, so the blue one is the ground state, the red one is the excited state. You can notice that they cross at some particular value. So it means that a laser at this wavelength, which will trap identically both internal states. Okay, this is the so-called magic wavelength, which is used in atomic clocks, optical atomic clocks. We also notice that there are other wavelengths where the polarizability are exactly opposite. Okay, so for example, here in the 610 nanometers. It means that if you realize a trap, an optical lattice, for instance, at this particular wavelength, atoms in the ground state will be trapped at the intensity maxima, while atoms in the excited state will be trapped at the intensity minima, so shifted by alpha wavelengths in a one-dimensional standing wave. So combining these two, you can realize an optical lattice in 2D, which looks like this. So along Y, the optical lattice uses the magic wavelengths. So the trapping potential is identical for both ground state and excited state atoms. But now along X, you use one of these anti-magic wavelengths so that basically atoms in the ground state or in the excited state organize in two different sublattices which are shifted with respect to one another by alpha lattice spacing here. Okay? And so now for simplicity, I will assume that atom can tunnel freely along the y direction, but the X lattice is deep enough that tunneling is blocked. And one way to reintroduce tunneling into the problem is to add a laser which actively couples the two internal states. Okay? And so I'm zooming here on two wells, two neighboring wells along X to illustrate the purpose. And so now, by absorbing a photon from the coupling laser, atom can change internal state, but in doing so, they also must change external state. Okay? And so in this way, you introduce a coupling between the motional state of the atoms, let's say, and their internal state. And if you if you write down the matrix element that that describes this coupling, so basically that describes hopping from the blue well to the red well, it will have some part corresponding to the overlap of, to the matrix element of the internal part of the wave function, and some part that depends on the external state or the motional state of the atoms, okay, with a contribution here which just reflects the recoil upon absorbing one laser photon and being promoted from G to E. And so now, this external part has a form which will depend on the position and which will therefore not be uniform across the lattice, so which is exactly what we need to realize the equivalent of the Aronoff-Bohm phase described previously in the Hofstadter situation. Okay. So there are a couple more complications which I'm going to gloss over. The fact that we have to use a super lattice, et cetera, to really enable laser-induced tunneling. So the details are in our paper here. But with this machinery, it's possible to realize an effective lattice where atoms couple, well, laser-induced tunneling, coupling ground state and excited state, will realize at low energies the Harper Hamiltonian we are looking for. And so the flux per unit cell here is basically given by up to a factor of numerical factor, is given by the ratio of the lattice spacing, so basically the wavelengths of the lasers that create the lattice, and the coupling laser, which are in general different. And we can reach a value for alpha on the order of 2/3 in our experiment, a value which gets tunable simply by changing the orientation of the lattice laser. All right? So this is basically the goal we would like to engineer. And so as a first step towards this goal, I'll now present a series of experiments where we basically use the clock transition to perform spectroscopy in a lattice gas. So this we work with a three-dimensional lattice, as illustrated here. So this series of plots shows that we can observe a transition from a superfluid state with high coherence to a multi-insulator state, where coherence is basically gone. Okay. And I should mention that these experiments I'm going to discuss are done in a magic optical lattice, so all trapping potentials, all three lattice axis potentials are identical for both the internal state G and E. Okay. So we're able to detect selectively the different internal states, either G or E or both together. And this shows basically a sketch to illustrate the fact that even if we work with a three-dimensional lattice, in fact, the system we are working with are two-dimensional. The depth of the vertical lattice is always very high. Okay, we can vary freely the depth of the horizontal lattice potentials, but we always freeze the motion along the vertical z-axis. So everything is basically equivalent to a stack of two-dimensional systems with variable lattice depths, okay? So in this talk, I will mostly discuss a situation where also the horizontal lattice is very deep, and so to a good approximation, tunneling between different sites is negligible, and you can really picture the system as an array of independent wells. Okay, so now we are performing spectroscopy on this clock transition by just to prepare the system as cold as we can in equilibrium, and then at t equals 0, we just shine the laser, and we watch how the population evolve in time. Okay, and so what we see here is the number. The blue curve shows you the atom number is the ground state, so which shows Rabi oscillations between the two internal states, whereas the black curve is the total number. Okay, and so this shows first that we are able to prepare the coherent superposition, condensate of coherent superposition in the ground state and in the excited state. Oh, sorry, it's not a condensate. Coherent superposition of atoms in the ground state and in the excited state, and that this persists for a long time. So after a few, let's say, 6 milliseconds, we see that the Rabi oscillations here damp, okay? That's one first observation. And the second observation is that there is a very strong decay initially, on a timescale less than a millisecond, typically. And then this decay stops, and we get some asymptotic oscillations with slowly decaying contrast. So that plot is for a relatively high atom number. I'm showing now a plot where the atom number is decreased tenfold. Okay, so here the peak is 10,000. Differently, I'm looking at now at the atom number in the excited state, so it's zero initially and then rises and oscillates. Okay, and so there is some noise which is essentially due to detection, but here we see a different behavior, so the initial decay is absent, and the contrast of the oscillation seems to remain relatively preserved up to some detection noise until 10 milliseconds. Okay, so to understand these observations, can go back to the spatial structure of a cloud that's expected in a regime of very deep lattice when we have a multi-insulator and beyond. Okay. So in general, you expect that for large lattice depths, you will form multi-insulator faces with a well-defined integer number of atoms per site and very little fluctuations. And in presence of an harmonic trap, like in our experiment, in general, you expect that there are several of these mod phases which coexist in the same trap. So a typical situation for us is plotted here. So this is density, and this is x and y coordinates. And we basically have a dense core with two atoms per site, okay, which is surrounded by a shell, if you want, with one atom per site only. Okay. And so now the outer shell basically corresponds to just a textbook Rabi oscillation. There is one atom. It cannot tunnel to the neighboring well. So all it can do is absorb a photon and gets to the excited state and then perform Rabi oscillations on that transition. Now with two atoms per site for the central core here, it's a bit more complicated. So at rest, in the beginning, we have atoms which are in the ground state and with some interaction strength UGG. But then, upon absorbing a photon, one atom can be promoted to E, where then the interaction strength in general will be different, so I will call it UEG. And then, absorbing another photon, you get the two atoms in the excited state, and they will also have a different interaction energy in general. I will call it UEE now. But now, in that case, there is also the possibility that those two atoms make an inelastic collision, and then they decay to some other state, basically, picking up a very high energy, and so they are essentially lost from the trap if such an inelastic collisional event occurs. So I'm writing it here as a dissipation rate, gamma EE. Okay? And in principle, there could also be a gamma EG for this type of situation, but we'll see later that it's negligible. Maybe one more thing to notice is that here the coupling strength, omega L, is augmented by a factor square root 2 as opposed to the single atom case. Okay? And this is just a consequence of the fact that since you have two atoms and they are bosons, you expect bosonic stimulation and an enhanced rate of coupling on this clock transition. Okay. So now, coming back to this curve, the way to interpret this very fast decay here is simply because of this strong inelastic losses. So W-occupied site basically start doing Rabi oscillation, but they also decay via this inelastic mechanism. Okay? And after a while, at the same time, the singly occupied site perform Rabi oscillations. And so after a while, the doubly occupied site have disappeared. And so you reach an asymptote here, where the oscillation persists, which is basically corresponding to a situation where you emptied the previously doubly occupied site, and you are left only with a singly occupied outer shell in your system. Okay? So in principle, the measuring this asymptote here corresponds to the proportion of singly occupied sites that you have in your system prior to applying your coupling laser. Okay? And so this is what we could report here. So sorry, this did not appear very well. So this is atom number. So here we have 80,000. And here this is 8,000 approximately. And the dots are the measured asymptotes for several experimental measurements similar to this one. And this is a model which assumes first that we are preparing the system in the, let's say, t equals zero ground state, and then that there are a few triply occupied sites that could also occur, but they decay very rapidly because of three body recombination in G, essentially. And so we assume that we can just model our system by considering an adiabatic loading at zero temperature and then erase the triply occupied site. And this is a solid line that you see here, which is describing pretty well the observations. So this gives us confidence that we understand the spatial structure, let's say, of the system we work with. And now we are using this coherent driving to basically perform spectroscopy of the interaction parameters in this system, which apart from the ground state are unknown. Okay, so I've mentioned several times that we have these inelastic collisions, which basically empty doubly occupied sites. I mentioned here that if you want to use the language of NMR, this is basically equivalent to a T1 decay time, okay? So it corresponds to a damping of the populations of doubly occupied sites. And so this shows a measurement where we prepare a sample purely with doubly occupied site in E, okay? And then you see some exponential decay, which allows to extract the coupling, the decay rate, which we find to be approximately equal to the interaction strength in the ground state. So typically 9,000 second minus one. On the other hand, this is a preparation of a mixture E and G, so one atom in E, one atom in G in doubly occupied sites. And there, mind the time, here it's seconds and here it's milliseconds. Here we basically cannot resolve any decay. So this decay is what also we would measure if we would put all the atoms in the ground state. Okay, so we can only put an upper bound on gamma GE and say that it is very small and we can neglect it to safe approximation. Okay, so just one remark that since the coupling is performed using a laser, it's not a plane wave, it's a Gaussian beam, and so it has some spatial variation, okay, which are weak, but which are not totally negligible for the largest atom number that we have. And so basically you expect that this the decay time corresponding to this, the dephasing time more than decay time corresponding to this, will go as a squared of the cloud radius, so the difference between the coupling rate in the center and at the border of the cloud. And that explains the different dephasing that we observed for large and low atom numbers. Okay, so for large, I should mention as well that, again, in the language of NMR, this is a T2 time. So T2, because it's only a dephasing because we are measuring the total number of atoms, but if we are measuring locally, we should be able to tell that atoms in the center or in the edge precess with a different rate. Okay, but we are making an ensemble averaging, and so this causes this apparent dephasing, so to speak. And now the radius for the largest atom number is about 20 microns, okay, which corresponds to a dephasing time of 10 milliseconds, which is very close to the time scale where we see dephasing, for instance, in that graph. Okay. And now for the lowest atom number, where no dephasing could be seen, then the radius is much smaller. You have only singly occupied sites. The radius is much smaller, 8 microns only. And that corresponds to basically four times or a bit more than four times bigger dephasing rate, meaning that on the time scale of 10 milliseconds we are exploring, it's negligible. Okay. And so that, with this combination of inelastic collisions and essentially inhomogeneous dephasing, we are able to explain the difference between the two curves for high and for low atom numbers that I've presented previously. Okay. Yes, and so this basically corresponds to the dissipation part of the physics that's involved. Now there is also elastic interactions described by this interaction parameter. So UGG, which is, this one is known, but UEG and UEE are not. And so to measure this, we perform spectroscopy using our ability to manipulate the Krug transition, but now in the frequency domain as opposed to the time domain for the previous curve. So here, this illustration here shows the laser detuning with respect to the bare atomic transition. So it's here, this is a resonance for single atom, basically. And now if you make a weak excitations, where you expect very little site with two atoms in E, where basically you expect some resonance peak corresponding to the transition with one atom in E, one in G, which will be shifted by UEG minus UGG, simply, okay? And so by monitoring this peak, we can simply determine the interaction shift UEG minus UGG. So experimentally, because of the losses in particular, it's not that easy to distinguish this peak. But I'll show you experimental data here where you see a line shape, which is basically the sum of two contributions corresponding to this shoulder here, where basically the resonance for GG to EG is showing up. So we can fit this with a calculation based on the model I've described previously of the discontinuity well with one or two atoms, okay, and extract collisional parameters here from this. Now, for the other collisional parameters, so the interaction of atoms in 2E, it could be measured in principle by looking at a two-photon transition, no? So making a weak excitation, strongly detuned, so that you don't transfer from GG to EG, but then the dominant process would become a two-photon transition, where you would go directly from GG to EE by absorbing two photons from the laser, okay? And then in that case, you expect a side peak here, which is shifted by the quantity with a factor of two here, reflecting the fact that it's a two-photon transition and not a single-photon transition as here. All right. So this also, because of the loss, is a bit complicated because you need very weak excitation, and then basically the EE sites are emptied before you can measure them easily. But you can also make use of the loss. So in this plot, what I show here is a total atom number, okay, as a function of detuning. And so if you drive your system under clock transition, and if you populate the state EE with two atoms in E, then they will be prone to loss, okay? Whereas all the other states that can be populated, either G with single atoms or GG and EG with two atoms, those do not decay. Only EE can decay. And therefore, if you look at the total atom number, you will see a decay resonance here, which will be centered at value UEE minus UGG over 2H bar that you'd expect for the two-photon resonance. Okay. So doing this measurement, this is experimental data. The total number here is shown in black. Doing this measurement, we found that the resonance, the expected resonance for GG to EE here actually almost coincide with the single atom resonance, which is shown in blue or red. Okay, so we find almost no shift corresponding to UEE approximately equal to UGG. And so here, so I'm sorry about that, the two figures are a bit hidden. So we find that UEG is about 0.8 times UGG, and UEE is 1.0 times UGG, okay? So, and so this is a bit surprising, because normally you expect that when you have very different internal states like this, the scattering lengths have no reasons to be equal. But so it seems to be probably coincidental. It's not the case for the fermionic species of ytterbium of strontium, as far as I know. But here, for this particular isotope, all the coupling strengths are very close to each other. Okay. And so this is also hidden, but this has been measured simultaneously by the group in Florence with final results very similar to ours. Okay. All right. That's my last, normally. And so I want to finish the talk by commenting, let's say, on the role of inelastic collisions. So as we said, the inelastic collision when you have two atoms in the excited state is pretty big. Okay, it's comparable to the interaction strength, which means that if two atoms in the excited state can be populated, the system is not going to live very long, and it's going to be difficult to do any kind of meaningful experiment with it apart from very short times measurements, okay? So fortunately, at least we hope that we can rely on a Zeno mechanism, if you want, which is augmented additionally by the interactions, and which will suppress the effective loss in this system. So I remind you some typical values for our system. And you see that the tunneling matrix element, when I know restore tunneling in my full lattice, is small compared to U and gamma for these parameters. Okay, so if I take now a model with only three wells, so two in the ground state, one in the excited state, then I will have laser-induced tunneling corresponding to this J here, which can promote the atom from G to E and then back to G. So this works fine as long as there is one atom. If I have two now, there will be an interaction shift, both for the atoms in G and for the atoms in G with a corresponding decay rate. Okay? So what that means is that in this regime of strong interaction, and if I work in the subspace, in the effective subspace with one particle, which will be enforced by the strong interactions. Then there will be a sort of collisional blockade, which will prevent, basically, atoms to absorb two photons and go to make a doublet pair in the excited state. And so this mechanism, this blockade mechanism, corresponds to a suppression of the loss rate for this effective one-particle subspace, again, which typically scale as J squared divided by either U squared or gamma squared, which one is the greatest. In our case, they are comparable. But the final result is that the effective loss rate will be much smaller than the bare loss rate for two atoms, typically by a factor of G squared over U, okay? So which is a large suppression factor, and which means that the loss rate will also be much smaller than the rate of tunneling. So it basically becomes the smallest scale in the problem. And so thanks to this type of effect, which it has been observed with polar molecules already and in several other systems, so we believe it will be present as well in ours, this effect will basically allow us to have a long-lived quantum gas in the optical lattice with the laser coupling and to meaningful experiments with them. So with this, I'll stop, and I will thank you for your attention.